All right, comic fan, I want to get into comic books that you have to hunt for and travel to find. You're putting in those miles in. You're putting in those airline miles in. And I chatted with Russ. He sent me a synopsis of one of his last voyages. And I got some other members of the community stories here as well that I'm going to share with you. But this is a story that took place, really, I think it was last year. He traveled to Cincinnati, had to fly down there with a co-driver so that on the way back, they can drive what was 14 long boxes from this person's house. And he said that when he arrived there, he was initially kind of disappointed that although there was an Avengers 1, there was a Marvel Spotlight 5, that when they were taking them out of these very old bags, the color, gloss, and the condition was better than expected. However, the disappointment came from when he was in a room standing with the owner, the original owner of these comics, and he was smoking a cigarette like he was damn Constantine the whole time. And what happens when comics are in a place with smoke? They start stinking. And that's exactly the situation he found himself in. He traveled all the way down there and he's pulling these out. And he said that he packaged these things quick. You know, they figured out the deal. But at the time, you know, he was pulling out the comics, trying to figure out if they smelled. And some did, some didn't really, but he didn't know how severe it was. It wasn't until he packed them up, drove them back to Seattle to really discover that every single one of these comics had to be taken out of the bag and board. It took, what he said, 4 days to take them all out and to, you know, carefully set them out. And that's when the timer started. They had to be like de-smoked. They had to air out for a long amount of time. And to this day, he's still battling smoke on some of these comics. Have you ever dealt with smoke, Jeff?
Not often, but that wasn't one of the deals. Like, I traveled to a deal in Indiana, okay? And I meet this guy, and just he's probably in his 80s at this point. And this may be the first time I ever traveled out of state for a collection, okay? I met this guy somehow on eBay through a book. Contacted him, go there, and he takes me to his house, and it's in this garage, and he has a massive amount of Golden Age books, massive. But the dude is an absolute asshat, okay?
Describe, what just made him an asshat?
Oh, he was a jerk. He was racist. I mean, he was, like, literally making all these terrible jokes, okay? And I was like, oh, my God, get me out of here.
Oh,
and,
my gosh.
And then
terrible.
We're in a closed garage, and he's puffing up smoke like crazy. And I started realizing these books stink of smoke. Okay. And I spent probably all day, well, half a day there. I had to get out of there because the guy was just the worst. Didn't buy a single book. I traveled all the way to Indiana, didn't buy a single book, took my money, left this dude. And it was just like, all right, man, I can't take you, dude. I got to go.
He's going to do it.
Yeah. That was like the worst smoke experience I ever had because you guys literally smoking while you're looking at books in an enclosed space. Doesn't even care. So I'm assuming that's probably what Russ had to deal with too.
Yeah, sounds like it. I reached out to our members in the community via Instagram, and I'm going to throw this out there for the community members watching this now. We will be sourcing comments from the comment section of our videos. And our next podcast, we're going to get into FOMO, fear of missing out. And if you have any FOMO stories that you don't mind us sharing on the mic, you can go to ComicTime101.com and hit the contact section to get in touch with us via the show, via email, if it's like a longer story. I'll read it. We'll probably do a synopsis of it. Or you can comment on the video. But keep in mind, we may talk about it on the show. I reached out via Instagram this week because it's been a while since we hit the mic. And Journo's Comics had something to say. You've seen him on YouTube, haven't you?
Yeah, he actually almost helped me out pick up a book in his area like 3 weeks ago.
No kidding.
Yeah, we actually spoke, and then we just couldn't communicate perfectly and get the timing right. But I like that dude, man.
Journals, Comics, and Pop Culture over on YouTube. Take a look at his YouTube channel. Does some really cool videos. He said that he drove from Sacramento to LA to another member's place to raid their 4 rooms. Of 50 cent books. Now that's some dedication. What do you expect he experienced? Because I'm imagining that, I mean, like if you're doing 4 rooms of 50 cent books, that's going to be a pretty dirty day. Like you have a really clean place, but you're still on the ground. You're hunched over, turning into a hunchback. Like you're pressing up against stuff. Like whenever I go to a con, my freaking knees get all like dusted up and stuff from the hunt, but man, it's worth it. Those 50 cent bins are fun.
I'll tell you exactly four people who would enjoy that type of environment. Four people.
Who?
One, people who just like comics for cheap.
Sure.
Two, completists.
Sure.
Three, people who love to read.
Absolutely. Okay?
And four, those who know that there's value in there because nobody's gone through these books yet. And the person who owns them has so many.
They don't even
that
care.
He can't even like contemplate how much effort it's going to take to find the book, but someone else will find it for you.
And you know what? When they do find it, they're like, good job. That's awesome. I'm glad you found something. You spent a half hour in that long box and you pulled out one book. Good on you. Take it. I mean, it's kind of the mentality of a lot of comic book stores that have back issue bins, isn't it?
It is. And the worst is the ones who don't have a price on them and then they wait for you to dig it out and then they eBay it and look for it in front of your face.
Oh, that.
Oh, yeah. Let me get the price on this. Really?
The comic fam knows what we're talking about here. That's definitely something we do not enjoy, but it does happen. The boy who had seven on Instagram, he said this. He's traveling this very weekend for the first time to go visit his cousin whose ex-wife's uncle passed away and left her a comic collection. Now, first off, our condolences. That's very sad. However, how often is this something similar that happens in the hunt for comic books? In that, it doesn't have to always be like a, like something tragic, like a death, but your cousin's uncle's friend who they worked with has comics. And because they knew that you are someone into comic books, that they got in touch with you. Like you, it's a learning experience here. You got to make sure everyone in your life knows that you're into expensive paper, because the day that someone knows someone or gets told that they have something, they're going to reach out to you.
Yeah. Like everybody knows like a real estate agent. Okay. Right.
Yeah. It's just like that.
Yeah. Everybody knows a real estate agent. You're like, oh yeah, I know an real estate agent. They know, like, everyone knows like five. All right. This, there's not many people who know comic book collectors. Okay. Oh, yeah, I know somebody. Yeah, let me get you in contact. So the more people that know what you like and the less maybe ashamed you are putting it out there, or you're just out there and loving it and everybody knows in your group, the more likely you're going to get a contact at some point. So it's really important to just put that out there in the universe, at least in the universe you live, which is your bubble, wherever you are and the people you know, and just be like, bam, I'm into comics. Tell me if anything ever comes up.
I had a collection that was at my grandma's house that was left from when my dad initially left Buffalo, New York when I was a kid. I went back to visit and it came up in conversation with my grandma and my family. And I'm like, oh, I'm into comic books. I'm like, oh yeah, you like comic books like your dad did, you know, like, yeah, it's kind of fun. And she's like, yeah, there's a couple boxes upstairs still. And it's like, had I not brought up the fact that, hey, this is something I'm passionate about, that I'm into, I would have never looked. I went upstairs, two long boxes. It was some of the very first Hellboy comics I ever secured. You know, and nothing huge, but like a full run of Seed of Destruction and Wake the Devil and a bunch of 90s stuff. They had some like Young Blood. There was a Bloodshot, you know, Zero in there. You know, there was a handful of like books that were worth some money and I couldn't bring them all back home. I didn't have a way to, you know, lug long boxes back. It was just me on this trip. So what I did is I put together like a stack of books, took clothes out, put the clothes in my backpack, and then secured them in my suitcase the best way I could and wrapped them up in clothes and brought them back home. I mean, you got to always bring this kind of stuff up. You got to let everyone know that you're passionate about comics. Spread the word, you never know. And you got to hear this comment from a member in the community. This is Bub Collects. He says, this guy had an apartment with a house full of comic books that I had to travel to. When I got there, he was playing Mario Kart. The deal was, if I won, he would give me 50% off of the agreed price. So how is that for a story? Not only do you need to be like, you know, on the hunt and know who you're dealing with, build and rapport, because that's really what that's about. You also got to be good at some video games, apparently, because you may get a good deal.
And, you know, look, everyone's great at Mario Kart, okay? we all know how to zoom around corners, okay? You just got to hold down that little top left button, all right? So that's anytime you can get some kind of discount, whatever way. I mean, you know, I'm not saying whatever way. I'm just saying, like, if there's an opportunity there, you know, get to know the person. It helps not just to come in there and be like, you know, like you already bought it from this guy, you know, or this gal. Just So I don't know. Like you said, I think that's important to build some type of rapport and relationship. And Mario Kart, that's freaking hilarious, man.
So I have a message from Very Gary, another fellow YouTuber that everyone should be following. He's been on the show a handful of times. He's going to be on the show some more. He mentions that he traveled to New York, traveled from New York to Virginia to secure a collection. And everything went well. All right. But he had some points here that I wanted to bring to the mic because I thought it a really good lesson to be learned from his experience, because I want to rope this into a deal that you just did. You just got back from San Francisco a couple of days ago to secure how many comics?
Just two.
Two comics.
Really one. I went down there for one.
You went down there for one. You came back with two because that's how you do it. But this is what Very Gary had to say. He said that during his phone call conversation, he was able to tell that the collector was a serious one. The collector had said that he wanted to keep all of his Wolverine books because he was thinning out his collection. All points that are important to keep in mind when you're doing a deal, because it tells you a lot about the person you're buying from, right? He's having a verbal conversation with the person. He also said that he felt that he had a good price point figured out because they were trading information on what books were going to be involved. He had a list of comic books that he was able to get. That doesn't happen all the time, right? Like, you get lucky if the person's cataloged their collection, but sometimes the big keys or the bulk of the collection will be cataloged, and it gives you some price points to start at. He also said here that it's important to have a list and a ballpark of what you're looking to spend on the collection. Try to figure out something prior to making the travel happen, because you don't want to come back empty-handed. You don't want to pay for the flight. You don't want to pay for the overnight stay and not get comic books because you guys couldn't figure it out in person.
Yeah, it's interesting what you're saying there, because there are some stuff is still tried and true from even back in the day. You know, you want to make a phone call. You want to get that information correct.
Right.
Okay. And I think I'm seeing a lot more people have books in their collections and databases. I think because there's so many online platforms now that give you an automatic total.
Shout out Key Collector Comics. Use code TOM101 for a free 2 weeks.
And that's just something that I'm seeing a lot more of, because they don't know the values. They'll let some software figure it out for them, and then they'll know, and it's easy to forward on. So I've seen that a ton now.
Isn't it pretty typical, like, when someone has a collection? Oh, and Butch is demanding attention. He just jumped on the table, Comic Fam, for our audio listeners. Again, available on SoundCloud, Spotify, Stitcher, and iTunes if you don't have time to watch us. But you know what? We're in crystal clear video for the Comic Fam. People who have collections that they're not sure about, there's typically a path that they go down. And seldomly does that path lead them to learning how to grade, taking pictures of all the books and listing them fairly, and then going through shipping and or taking them to a convention and selling them. Sometimes it leads there. Most of the time, it starts out with, I'm going to see what they're worth. They go on eBay, and they're more discouraged after the fact because they find out that there's different grades. They sell for all across the spectrum, and it ends up putting them in a position to go, I just want someone to take them all off my shoulders.
You know, that's part of it. There's a lot to it because it's usually a case-by-case basis. But, like, before you go to that collection, getting that information is important. I'll give you an example when I say tried and true, because it's been something that people have been doing for a very long time. We have a friend, Gus, over at Silver Age Comics.
Shout out, Gus. I freaking love that guy.
Yeah, out in Manhattan, He used to have a store in Manhattan, but now he has one just in Queens.
Gus is one of the OG New York dealers. Literally, I've heard stories about his employees standing outside selling comics on the street like it's a freaking newspaper. Like, we're talking like Turok One days. He remembers when he got cases, you know? It's always fascinating.
I'll tell you how OG is. His account number for CGC is below 25.
Holy smokes. How freaking cool is that?
Okay. So if you think about, like, the starting people who started it probably have an account number and how far behind he was on that, like, that's early. So he was, he does his, you know, you in the early 90s, this is where when he had this collection he was telling me about, like mid 90s, you know, it was more common for Detective Comics and Action Comics, Golden Age books at the time. Sure. Still. Okay, so there's questions you go through because there's reprints. There's the famous first editions, which were like oversized of Action 1, Detective 27.
We've all been there. You think, oh, is this it? Is this the one? And it's not.
But when you ask the right questions and you find out like the other years of other books, having conversations with people, you start thinking he quickly realized this is the real deal. He goes to this house. Okay. Meets them. And in a, inside of a litter box, it's an empty litter box. There's no kitty litter in there, but stored in a, like a peed up, like litter box smelled is a Detective 27, Detective 28, Detective 35, Detective 38, First Robin. Okay. And like, wow. Some other random Golden Age books.
Can you imagine Target. Finding that in a litter box, what you would feel like?
Yeah.
I mean, oh my gosh.
Yeah. And so apparently at the time, Tech 27 was guided good for $11,000. That's it. I mean, right now, I don't even know what a good sells for right now. Right, or not even sells for, guides for, but probably 150K.
At least.
I'm going to guess. I mean, it could be off, but like that just shows you how far the market has gone. So like you ask your questions, you get there first. Okay, and you try to acquire these things, but do like I've been on my first two travel trips for comics. I didn't ask enough questions, okay, because sometimes you get that feeling that if you ask too many questions, they're going to wise up. So there's that line. So you don't know who you're dealing with, and you might just, there might be no way to get out of that, okay? And so, and my other one was I asked, maybe I could ask a few more questions, but the other person was lying. Ooh. Or misleading, because there were restored books. You know, like when somebody who knows a lot about the hobby and they're trying to sell you something for a deal, that's something you should be wary about. You're like, why do you know some, why is this a deal? Okay. And that should be a red flag already.
Sure.
So there's just these little things that you just need to know when you're out on the hunt like that in the wild that usually you get from experience because you've been burned before. You didn't count the pages of a book. You didn't check for restoration. And, you know, like, those are industry stuff you guys have to incorporate in your practices when looking for books, no matter where you are, really.
All right. Well, with that said, why don't we tell them about this amazing grail that looks so damn beautiful on this table. Never seen one in person. And tell us the story, because you secured a very important key comic book. Walk me through it. We have the first appearance of the Green Lantern from the Golden Age.
All-American Comics 16.
Hot damn, dude.
1940.
Dude, and the fact that it's as low as great it is, the cover looks amazing. I wasn't expecting it to look so crisp and intact. Dude, I thought you were going to bring back like a sliver of a cover. And this thing looks, it presents like a VG, man.
Yeah, it does. It presents at least as a VG. It's a gorgeous book, great colors. And let me tell you the story about getting to this book. So I am out of town. Okay, and I get a text message from a friend of mine who lives in the area. Okay, this is out in the San Francisco area. Okay, and popped up on Craigslist was an All-American 16. Okay, and it was graded as, he put it as a 5.0, and then he wanted $50,000 for it. Okay, if it's a true 5.0, that's actually a pretty good deal. But you look at it, you're like, that's not a 5.0. That looks more like a 3.0, maybe 3.5. From the photos and flaps, like things flapped over, but you can always put them back and you don't know how the spine is. And so I sent him an email just straight up like, hey, it's a cool book. I'm interested. Just really down to earth. You know, you never know when people stuff on Craigslist. So it's still, you're like, try to be cautious. And I just left it at that. Okay. I told him it's like a 3.035. I'm still interested in the book. Let's talk.
Okay. And around what time frame is this?
So this was just like 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago.
So this whole deal happened in under a month.
Oh, yes. Happened under a month. So a week later or so, he gets back to me finally. And I'm still traveling and heading home. And I'm overwhelmed. And I still don't believe that the book's still available. It seemed a little weird and sketchy because it's such an important book. It's like top probably 5 or 6 and most important books of the Golden Age and probably most valuable, to be honest. So I just let it go and then got home a couple days later and I got a text message from the gentleman too. And I was like, oh, and the text message seemed more sincere. And I'm just like, all right, well, maybe I should reach out. So I reached out to this gentleman, spoke to him, and super nice guy. And we hit it off well. And I just think that too many people dismissed it because it just seemed like one of those things that was just like so far-fetched of a concept that this grail of a book happens to pop up on Craigslist. That nobody approached it.
Whoa. Didn't get one call?
It just feels that way because he had no information from anybody.
Yeah, you'd think a dealer some at some point would, you know, pique interest enough to shed some information.
And I know some people did see it, but they just didn't approach it. And I mean, there's a lot of sharks in that area, man. A lot of sharks. So I was surprised. But we spoke and spoke, and then it got to the point where I was going to have a friend who lives down there. I was like, oh, maybe my friend can meet up, take a look at the book. Oh, my friend was there for 6 months, and the day I needed him to go down there, he had driven away and was like 800 miles from where he was.
Is that Ron?
Yeah.
Shout out Ron.
Yeah, shout out Ron, man. He was like 25 miles from Portland. He was just like, oh, God, I've been there for 6 months, and now you call? And so I was like, all right, well, now I'm in this situation. If I wait any longer, either he's going to get contacted or he's going to take it somewhere else. And there's a lot of big stores out there that would, you know, would try to intervene and take that book for me. So I contacted him. I tried to hold him off as long as possible, be like, hey, you know what? You don't feel comfortable probably meeting a friend of mine anyway. And, you know, we've talked for quite a bit of time now. Why don't I just come by tomorrow? Okay, and we will just figure this out. You know, we've kind of got an idea of what numbers we're comfortable with. And then you have questions about taxes. So there's always that. You know, there's people who want to know what to do with these type of items. And let me tell you a story about the book where it came from, too. This was bought by his dad. His dad was born in 1924, 26.
Okay.
This book came out in 1940. All right. And in 1978, he found it with his cousin. And they bagged it, all right? And it's been sitting for 45 years tucked away now.
Wow.
Okay. His dad passed away in 2006, and he just came upon the box again and found it and started Googling up some of these books. And it was just like, he told me, like a reality TV show where you watch it and you find like an antique Hummel or some, you know, some antique in your, like a wooden cane you didn't realize is made of whatever. And you look it up and you're like, oh my God, it's the real thing. So that's what he did when he saw this book. So obviously when you don't know what you're doing, you see the prices and you just assume that that's the price, that's the grade, blah, blah, blah. So we worked from that, but it was a really surprising moment. And they, you know, it was going to a really good family, you know, just a really nice guy. It'd be him and his sister. The book was left to. And so when I convinced them that I'm going to come down and I'll just bring some money and we'll meet at a bank and I'll transfer you some money as well and we can figure this out. Let's just take a look at the book together and we'll go through it because there were some discrepancies of what the grade could be.
Yeah, he was hoping for a 5.0 and you're already going, it'd be lucky to be what?
Yeah, at that point, just to surmise part of it, we kind of concluded that he told me that the spine was almost completely split, he remembered. And he had a lot of pictures, so he sent me pictures. And I couldn't fully tell if it was completely split or not because of the way it was covered. So I gave it as like a 1.5, because if the split is that big that he said it was, it's probably closer to 1.5, maybe 1.8. Okay, he agreed. And I was like, okay, I have to book a flight. Right now it's like 4 p.m. our time, okay? Well, West Coast, we're staying on the West Coast, so it's 4 p.m. I booked a flight for 7.30 p.m. because I wanted to get in there and sleep the night instead of coming in super early in the morning just being tired. I quickly throw together a flash sale on IG.
I saw that.
For 1 hour.
That's why you were like, dude, can you share this stuff real quick?
Yeah.
Repost this. Follow the Golden Age Guru on Instagram, by the way.
Yeah, thank you, man. I wanted to...
If this gets out in time for the weekend, we're doing a claim sale. And if it doesn't, we do a claim sale every single month on the Guru's Instagram. But yeah, we got some dope books and you're going to take a bunch of them over right now.
Yeah, that's right. I am. So I did a quick flash sale for 1 hour. I was like, you know what? Let the hobby pay for itself here.
Yeah, good rule.
Yeah, and so I quickly sold like a quick 10K plus books. Like I just threw out Hell some yeah. books. I was like, let's just get them done, all right? And quickly asked for payment right away. Everybody was cool because I do sales all the time. And, you know, people. It's a great community in IG if you guys aren't out there yet. It really is.
Shout out IG Comic Fam.
Yeah, seriously. So flew out and my wife's like, you got to go, man. It's like 5:30. The airport's like 45 minutes away. So I was like, yeah, thanks, babe. I got to go. And threw some stuff in a backpack, hit the road, and landed. And when I got there, I was like, okay, I'm going to get some rest, get some food, just mentally play this out and be ready and hit the – and then got some sleep, woke up, and headed to the bank. I was like, all right, I got there like 15 minutes early. He was there like 30 minutes early. He told me he was really punctual, so he really wanted to get the lay of the land.
He wanted that money, dude. He's like, I got to go meet this guy. This guy's coming from Washington. He wants this freaking paper. This is super old. He's got this like Green Lantern. I don't even look like Green Lantern on the cover. What is this guy doing?
So, yeah, I get to the bank. I pull up there. He's sitting there. I meet him for the very first time. Okay. Nice guy. He has this like briefcase. Okay. Like this old leathery strappy briefcase they're in.
Did he have a handcuff on the briefcase? Is he doing any of this kind of stuff?
He had two hands on him like this, just like heading it, sitting in a chair. Like,
he's like holding it with his dear life.
Yeah. And I was like, hey, nice to meet you. I'm Jeff. And let's secure this little, there's a little cubicle. This is Chase Bank. Shout out to Chase Bank, by the way. I love Chase Bank. Everyone I go to is amazing. I love Chase Bank. And they had this little cubicle we can go into, so we went to this cubicle space.
Oh, my gosh. You're doing this deal at a Chase Bank?
I'm doing it at
Chase Bank.
You're
looking at the comic book in there?
Bank
manager's like, what's this guy doing in there? Oh, I got a comic book. I don't know.
No, I mean, I went in there like a freaking own the place. I was like, forget this, man. I'm doing this deal. Done.
I need an office now.
Yeah, I was like, I need two pens, and I need two envelopes right now. I really did, man. I was just like, okay, we're going to take this over. Give us time. I need one more chair for him, because there's only one chair in here. Yeah, I was like, you know, I just wanted to like, look, I'm coming in. I know what I want to do, and I know what I'm doing. Okay, I'm not like going to him and haw and like, I don't know, you know, because this is an opportunity, guys. You got to understand, when you have an opportunity to pick up something, don't let a good deal, like, don't miss on a good deal, okay, and like walk away out of spite, pride necessarily, you know, whatever.
It may never happen again. Like, this is a once in a lifetime type of thing. Like, that's why this is you know, Quentin Tarantino with, this is part of your PC, or are you gonna, what are you gonna do with it?
Oh, that's saying my PC.
So this is a PC book just for the comic fam to know. But anyways, continue.
Actually, I've walked out on Pride too, so disrespect.
I was gonna say, dude, you straight up told me, dude, I would have left there. I've kissed my ass.
I've done that. I flipped the table, said, screw you, I'm out of here. No, that's not true. I didn't do that, but I would leave actually on Pride. But what I'm saying is just, you know, don't walk out on stuff if you just out of like for $5. The biggest regrets I've always had is not buying a book.
Right.
Than actually spending the money on it. So anyways, we get there. He opens up this briefcase. It's got these straps over. There's no bag supports. These are like 45-year-old bags.
Oh, okay? Man.
But the paper, it was tucked away. And the paper on it is like either white or off-white to white. I mean, this book's interior was nice. So I look at it and he pulls out like four books. Okay. He had a Superman 3 with no back cover.
Oh, nice.
Okay. And a big spine roll in issues. It's probably, it's a 0.5. And he had an All-American Comics 19, first appearance of the Atom. And then another book, an All-American 9. And then the All-American 16. Obviously, that was easily the biggest book by far.
Sure.
So I look at the All-American 19, and all that's on there, I see the All-American 19 cover. And then underneath that, I see another cover. It's like, what? And then I slide the cover off of the 19 because it's like three quarters of the cover, not attached to anything. I was like, okay, this is an All-American 5. Here's your cover to All-American 10. And I was like, so you probably have a coverless All-American 19 somewhere because he said he had parts. So here's the cover for it. This is a complete All-American 5, which is just a not worthless, but it's just an old anthology book of history stories. It doesn't have a ton of value. And I told him you probably have the back cover for the Superman 5 as well somewhere. So like, I told him I'm not really interested in those, and you probably want to pair them up for now, and we'll figure it out. Let's just work on these two books because we get it.
Doing him a solid, building some rapport.
And so
it's
before
good.
I handle the books, he had these rubber gloves. Okay, he's under the impression. He told me, can you please wear these gloves? I was like, actually, I'm not going to wear those gloves. I don't feel comfortable wearing comics with gloves, and nor really should I, because I need to be able to feel it. And I may cause more damage because.
Whoa! You're not going to wear gloves with comics? Yeah. What?
Yeah, right. I'm not going to wear those gloves because I need to feel for any type of changes in the paper, whether it's any type of glue or any restoration. And I may catch something with the rubber of the glove and damage the book more. And I explained that to him. He's like, oh, okay, that's great. I didn't know that. So we put it aside and I just go through the book and realize immediately it's a complete spine split. Okay, great. I don't have to freaking coddle this book. I put both covers aside. I was like, great. Let's go through the interior. Okay.
Yeah, because when the book is a certain grade, it's not going to go lower. As long as you're not like lighting it on fire or dousing water on it, it's as low as it's going to go. And that's what happens. You can be a little bit more, you know.
Yeah. You don't have to worry about opening it and the cover detaching or the spine splitting depending on, you know,
it's already split.
You know, it's split. You just move it aside and you go through the insides now. And the centerfold was attached. It was a nice book. I was like, okay, complete spine split. That's a 1-0.
Sure.
All right. And I took a bunch of photos online of 1-0s that had complete spine splits and detached covers. So eventually, you know, he told me 1.5 because he read it on some website. And I was like, look, I just got three examples here. I'll show you. I never saw one with a 1.5. You know, maybe there was some fuddling around back in the day where you could tape your spines back together and it used to actually up the grade on the book from what I understand. But no, not anymore. That's a complete spine split. You know, talking to him, he came with a number. I was like, okay. And I was okay with that number, but I was like, you know what? This is where I want to be. And so we negotiated to a point where he was happy and I was happy and gave him some money. And you'll get into situations with big books too, that a lot of people who are uncomfortable with dealing with a lot of cash or valuable items. So they actually almost want the deal to be done, and they'll just be happy to get the money. They'll be happy to not have to worry about this item because it's got value, and they see value in the dollar more than they see value in the item. So you're doing them a really big favor sometimes with these people. And I've met quite a few now when you get into these bigger items who are just wanted out of their possession and move on and take that money and do something with it that, you know, they rather enjoy doing. So we got done with the deal, gave him the money, gave him a check, you know, said bye. And what I did do, because I wanted the deal to be official, is I was like, let's use your gloves. So we each put on one glove shook hands and said, hey.
Because COVID, of course.
Because of COVID. Yeah. I was like, all right, like, let's just do it. And so this is my glove in memory of it with the comic on top of it. And
now you have an All-American.
All-American 19. I left the bank, like, unbelievably happy. And I'm still, like, shocked, you know, like.
Spill the beans, man. You're back on the show.
All right.
Podcast 36, Comic Fam. Hit the subscribe button. What's going down?
All right. Let's throw in some numbers then. Okay. Let's talk about. I paid, let's just say, above 20 for this book. Okay. Which I did. Below 30, above 20.
$20?
Okay.
$30,000.
Okay.
Okay. There you go.
This book, I feel, on a really good day at auction, could probably be $35,000, give or take. Okay. Then you include, you know, but for somebody to go do that who had financial concerns of tax repercussions and stuff going to auction houses, if you think about that, you know, if an auction house takes 20% buyer's premium from that price, so it adds 20% to it, and then they take 10% more from you, that's 30% off the actual sale price.
Right.
So if something sold for $35,000, and you take 30% of that, what is that going to be? $10,500 gone. So now it becomes an item that, you know, you just now, and then all that money goes to you to be recorded through the IRS, which, yep, is also another scare for a lot of people. So these are things you can play on and work for to give you a good deal on a book, and yet they still get the same money.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to brag about like some price that they got online when they really didn't get that number.
Right.
So we both got to a great point where I was happy with my number. He was happy with his. And now we're just both, you know, keep on keeping on.
What's the plan for this book? Are you sending it to get graded? Are you going to try to restore it? What are you going to do?
I'm definitely not going to restore it. Okay. I'm going to just enjoy it as much as possible.
Why definitely?
Obviously, restoration takes away from value. And all it does for me is maybe add eye appeal.
Yeah.
This book's got great eye appeal already. So I don't necessarily need that. I don't think there's anything here that needs conservation. So I'm not going to have to worry about that. So for me, I like blue label books. I don't care for all those other colors unless it's maybe yellow.
Sure.
Or black label or tuxedo label for pedigree. Right? So, and plus I don't know if I want to put any more money into it because it's going to cost quite a bit to get it graded. So I'll keep it raw for now. I'm sure it'll end up encapsulated at some
point.
I want
to see it in a slab, man. I'm super hyped. Because then we can bring it back to the mic and show the comic community. Comic fan, what do you think about this? This is crazy stuff, man. I appreciate you bringing this to the table to share a little bit about the process. I'm covered in cat hair right now. Because Butch demanded to chill with us. Because when we're chilling with our homies, that's what we do. And we now have a grail in the family because your family, Jeff. And because you're family, that means I actually have partial ownership of this as well. So I'm really excited. When you do get it graded, you have to bring it back is the point. You have to bring it back. I want to see it in the slab. Comic fan, we're putting pictures up. It doesn't do it justice to see a picture of this book. This is one of those ones where if you go to a convention, you have to go to the dealer floor We always recommend it, even just to look. This is one that would go behind glass, you know? This would be one that you would have to see through something else, and seeing it this close in person, it's a really special thing.
It's an extremely rare book. Like, there's less of this book.
I've never seen one in person.
Than Action
ever.
One.
I don't think I've ever seen one at a show.
Yeah, or Tech 27. The only ones I've ever seen, and I've seen just a couple of late in the last couple years, and I go to a lot of shows, have been restored. Okay, so I haven't seen a Blue Label one in a long time. And so it is a really special book.
Comic fam, I want to know your thoughts about this in the comment section below. Maybe Jeff will continue to bring his books from the PC to share with us on the mic.